Actually, what we're doing here today and what we wanted to do as ambassadors of the Dutch Design Week is actually, we see that a lot of young people that just graduate have no clue how to start, how to build up your practice and where to go. What is there and how you
can you hear us well, or is it?
Yeah, okay.
Bit, have to speak louder.
So basically, when we were asked to be ambassadors for the Dutch Design Week, we said what we can bring to this week is actually our knowledge and share that with the audience. So I also see that there was a little bit of confusion about the art and collectible talks, because we really specifically wanted to invite students to, or people that are just graduated, because we're going to go through some practical things. But even for people who are not exactly here to build up their own practice, I think it can still be interesting, because you see a lot of the background of what designers, artists come across when they build up their practice. So that to be said, well, this is Ralph. So basically 20 years ago, Ralph and me met each other here in Eindhoven at the introduction camp of the Design Academy. And we lived for 10 years in Eindhoven. We started our studio there. We're now based in Amsterdam. And I just go quickly through a few slides to show you a little bit of our studio. Today we are 64 people. We were so surprised ourselves that we have such a big team.
We had a show in Charlotte in the States, and then they put all the names on the wall, and we were counting, like, we were saying like 40. I thought that was already a lot, but it's like, shit, that's a lot of people. But
so it happens. Basically, we make our works ourselves. We produce everything, but we also work a lot with tech partners, and we outsource everything that we can outsource. But still, there remains always a big part that nobody else can do but us. So that's the part that we do, and that keeps us already incredibly busy. Well, that's me, Ralph.
Very inspired, huh?
Very inspired. This is Ralph's office. This is my office. This says already a lot about how different the both of us are, and the combination of us is basically our work, our studio, how everything is organized in an organized and unorganized way.
Yeah, but you're more organized in your mind, and I'm just, it's one big chaos in my mind, so that's why I need a very clean office, basically.
Exactly, and and I don't need that, because within the mess I can find all my stuff I need. Actually, I got a little bit better. I can watch here the slides. So we do a lot of research. We work a lot with very vulnerable materials, but our work is mainly about everything that you cannot grab, and it's about the experience and the feeling that we try to evoke in the installations that we make. And we build up, we develop, test, prototype, build up everything in our studio, and before it goes out. That's one of the big lessons we learned. Don't go with an untested work to a client, hang it up, and come to the conclusion that it doesn't work. So that's very important if you work like us with technology, that you actually can deliver. And we learned that the hard way. So how nice and proud we are on our studio today. It wasn't always like that.
For people that don't know what we do, we combined new technologies with natural elements or natural movements to reestablish the connection with nature to technology. That's what we basically do in all our work.
So this slide is actually our first studio in 2007 was here in Eindhoven. It's in the location where the Blob is, and it was just behind there. And that was like first a copy shop, and a lot of people who were at the Academy in our time went there to do copies. It was just in front of the Academy, like next to the Bruine Heer. And we got an anti-kraak, anti-squat space, and then we made it beautiful, and we made our own tables, and we made nice pictures. But actually, in reality, it usually looked like this. And we were just working our asses off, not really knowing how to do anything or how to start. So we wanted to start. I also found this picture in the middle of the night. It was just before the Dutch Design Week 2006. It was a year after we graduated. We were working on the Shy Lights. And then I found a picture of 5 years later, me again still working on the Shy Lights, still the same project. that never ended. And now still working at night with people and just making a mess. But basically, we want to start with a couple of examples, and we're also going to go through some numbers just to give examples of how things function, how things work. Milan 2008.
Yes.
This was quite funny. It was a story of when we graduated from Design Academy, the first thing was that we thought we have to make a chair. It's really, I don't know how it's nowadays when you graduate from the Academy, if you still think that. But we were really like, oh, the chair is the ultimate design object. That's what we need to make. Everyone has a chair. So we also had a chair. So our chair was one of the first things, I think, that we designed. And it was the ghost chair. And we made the first one in 2007. When we presented one in Milan, it was finished like halfway of the Milan week, and we had our neighbor bringing it in to Milan, and we put it there, and then we got a publication in the frame. And
we're like, yes, we made it. Done.
Yeah. It was just not even finished because we had found a technique that we found very fascinating, which is called subsurface laser engraving. And that was the technique for which you have these little blocks where Eiffel Towers are made, and in it, like this very cheesy technique. But we thought, actually, it's very interesting. You can do beautiful things, and why are there such lousy things made with that technique? So we found out who was the producer of these machines, and we got on the phone, and then we said, yeah, come see us. So we went to Germany and talked to them and said, we want to make a chair out of your technique. And they said, like, well, we've never done that before. We only have machines like this big, but soon we have a machine that is bigger. And we said, yeah, can we work for the first time with your machine? And they said, yes, fine. And basically it was a collaboration. Also, they had not the experience with it. And
it was a great process, only we had no idea how much it was costing, because they were also helping us with the technology. They were putting the effort in, finding the materials. And of course, like when you start as a designer, you're also not calculating your hours. We still don't do that, by the way. But anyway, so you have no idea how much it costs. So
we had only this one chair and this publication, and then the help of this manufacturer. And also this manufacturer brought us in contact with another company in Germany who had a special plexiglass that was specially developed for subsurface laser engraving, because there was big expectations for this technology. So we also used that technique, and it was in 50 millimeter thickness. So anyway, we had everything set up, and then we got this publication, and then we got a phone call from an architect. It was Neo Architects from Rotterdam, if I'm not mistaken. And they said, we want to buy 8 chairs. We were like, yes, the first time that someone wants to buy our chairs. And
but to be honest, like, we also at that point, we didn't even think about selling it. I mean, we also had no idea there was a market. The only idea we needed to do this because
we wanted to make that work.
Yeah, we just wanted to make work that we had in our mind. And it was even with the first exhibition that we had, that they asked us, how much are we selling it for? We're like, we don't know how much we're selling it for. The goal is to show it. That was the main reason. So we were a bit,
we can
bit
say
lost.
We were extremely naive. Very, when we started. And then, so we got the order of those chairs, and so we had to make up a price. We didn't even know what the cost was. So we sold it for, I believe, 3,000 euros per chair. But we didn't know if we could make it for that money.
We didn't even know how much it was going to cost
to
make.
So
it's more like, that sounds like
euros.
A lot of money. So let's see if they go for it. And
so basically what happened, I mean, we had to basically make this work. So we went to the producers, and then they said, like, yeah, but I mean, it's going to cost 2,000 euros to laser engrave, because now we're going to do it commercially. You know, it was no help anymore. We had to sell it, and then we tried to find the same producer with this very special plexiglass, and they said, no, we decided not to produce it. So we only have 60 millimeter thick plexiglass. We sold it for 50 millimeter. And then we said, wow, and then we found out that we actually couldn't cover the costs at all for the order that we had placed. And then an advisor told us, why don't you ask for an extra favor? Why don't you ask that you can present these chairs in Milan before it goes to that client, so that at least you get the benefit of showing your work, having work that you can show, and show it in Milan. We thought, yes, that's a great idea. So we went to Milan, we found a space, and we thought, well, let's show the works in Milan. Then we found out, sorry, I'm going a bit confused, but we found out that the material could not be delivered. We already admitted or confirmed the space in Milan, we already paid. And then this client said, no, I don't want it in 60 millimeters, I want it in 50 millimeters. So they canceled the order. And suddenly we didn't have money anymore to present our work in Milan, and the space was already taken. So somehow we had to find money. So basically there was a bank, it was called Bissner Bank. It already doesn't exist anymore, but it was a bank for professionals. And you could immediately have a loan of 5,000 euros, or you could be 5,000 euros in debits. So we both took a bank account, immediately took both 5,000 euros, so we had 10,000 euros, because the space was costing 9,000 euros in Milan. And, well, then we come across so many problems, but at the end of the day, we managed to not produce all the chairs, just a couple of chairs. We were completely out of money, and we had still 60 euros, and that was the last money, and from the 60 euros, we had to drive to Milan.
Yeah, so we had a tank full of gas, we had a couple of bites in the car, and that's how we had to make it to Milan. So we had to also keep the car under 90, I think, to make it, but once there, the show looked amazing. By selling some smaller pieces there, we could get some gasoline to drive back.
And also, we ended up at the campsite, but we couldn't pay for it.
Not yet, so we just bluffing. So we'll pay later.
So during that week, we sold some small dandelions, and with that we could pay the campsite and we could eat. But there were also plenty of free places where you can eat during Milan. So this is how we survived. And this was, maybe we can turn the video on. This was the exhibition. Also the video, when I look at it now, I think like,
It's not a video, it's just like a bunch of pictures stick together, but it worked.
It actually looked pretty good, but what did we do? We got a space on Via Tortona, but it was in the NL Hotel, and it was on the second floor. So nobody could see that exhibition.
There was there was nobody coming by, and then we're quite stressed, because this is like basically all the effort and funding that we could achieve.
So we got super stressed.
Yeah, so we decided to print a lot of posters and then stick the whole city full of posters. Every night in the night we were just, you know, bombing the whole city with these A3s about where the show was.
And then it worked really well.
Yeah, and then people started to come, and actually became also a thing after, like, the next year you saw everybody doing it. So we're like, yes, made a trend.
But of course, this was all our investment. This was everything or nothing, so we had to make the most out of it. And then one moment, there was a guy coming in, and apparently he was a collector from New York. And he came to our desk and said, I want to buy a chair, or maybe I want to buy a couple of chairs. We're like, yes, and we gave him the price. So it was again like maybe the production cost plus 30 euros or something. So he said, like, that seems a little bit cheap. And we said, like, well, we don't really know how to calculate. He said, why don't you calculate it? Well, ask some advice, and I come back tomorrow. So I remember very well, and I don't know if... are Kiki and Joost here right now?
No, we're just sitting.
We just had dinner.
Yeah, we went to them, and he asked them, so basically, how do we make a price? And then they told us, and we were like, okay, that's a different price.
So the next day, the guy came back, and we gave him a new price, which was four times the price or something, as we had said. And then he said, like, how did you get from here to here? You know, he was totally confused. And then I did something maybe stupid, but maybe also good, that you should never maybe give out your production price. But I told the guy, yeah, but I have to ask this money because it costs so much to produce it. And then he was like, what? Does it cost so much to produce this? He was like, well, okay, I get it. But he said, why don't I invest in you guys? Why don't I help you to produce this? I put up the money in front, and I help you bring the works out there. We do an exhibition together, and we said, yes. And I think this was the goal for us, to find something happening in Milan, and this was happening for us. Then we made the next mistake. This guy was a property guy from New York who was who loved design, who had that in his private collection. But we got so stressed of all this importance-ness, and suddenly we were talking about big money. So we said, like, let's ask some advisors to help us. And together with the advisors, we drafted a contract, how to collaborate, how to work together. But actually what happened, this guy was doing it for the love of it. He did it because he wanted to help us, because he thought it was fun. It is not his business. He just came up with the idea because I gave him the production cost, and he felt like, yeah, I should help these guys because they have no clue what they're doing, basically. And it ended in a very sad way because we started to draw contracts and everything became so sad that the fun of it was gone. And he said, like, well, you know, I don't want to do business with you. I just want to help you. And this way, we're going in the wrong way. So we totally lost the project with him. And yeah, this was a wise lesson, I think, for what we did. So just as an example, where we come from, this is not the way how you probably should do it. But it's... Can you hear me?
Ik hoorde net beter.
Okay.
Yeah?
I don't know. Is this better? So basically, what do you do when you start? How do you know where to sell your work? What do you want to do? Where do you want your work to be? Do you want to sell it through a label? Do you want to sell it, produce it yourself and sell it in a shop? Do you want to work with galleries? Do you want to be in museums? Or do you want to do something completely different? We see that a lot of people don't ask themselves these questions. They have no clue that they have a choice, that you can actually direct your own career. And we also didn't have a clue. We just took whatever we could in order to make a little bit of money and survive.
It was because it's always about the work. So this is the part that you don't want to think about. But in the end, if you're prepared, you actually have to think about it less. And I think that's also what we're trying to take you through these steps today.
So we're just going to take you through a simple calculation. And that is production cost versus profit. Because what does it mean when you calculate your production cost and how does it work in the end? This is a sample example. You have the out-of-pocket cost. That's your material cost, your shipping cost, your packaging, everything that you physically have to pay to someone else. Then you also have studio costs, your insurance, your administration, your storage, everything that you cannot immediately calculate on your production cost. Then you have the production hours. And basically, how much does it take to produce your work? How many hours does it take? Do you calculate your development cost? Or do you leave them out? For the simpleness of this, because this is not a written rule, what I'm going to have here. This is just a way of thinking how you should sometimes just put a few simple numbers on a spreadsheet. Well,
it basically works for us, you know, to,
exactly.
to calculate.
So you should calculate what it would cost if another person makes it, because if you're the one making it and you don't calculate any hours or money for yourself, you will never be able to survive. So basically calculate if you would hire someone else to make it. Then you always have unforeseen. So I put 15%, can be 10, can be 5, can be 20, depends on the risks of the project.
Don't make it too low, because there will be a moment when shit hits the fan, and it might be in one of five sales, so you better have that, you know, reserve to counter that, otherwise your profit goes into it, and again, you're at zero. So it's an important one.
And then, do you put a margin on this? What if you calculate the first four lines, it is €1,064.50. And if you would put a margin of it of 50%, it means that is your profit. You double the price. Because if you would outsource this completely, they would also double the price. I'm not saying you have to do this. It's just a way of thinking. You could do this. Basically, the total production cost, or the total cost for which you can sell the work, is €2,093. In this case, it's just a random example. It's not based on anything. It's just a calculation. What happens if you sell this in a shop?
Or gallery, or?
Well, in this case, I just put a shop just to make it very simple, because galleries have a little bit different percentages.
That's true.
But a shop also needs to have their storage. They need to they need to pay their rent, they need to pay their employees, they need to do their marketing. So a shop multiplies the cost for which they buy the work from you times 2.2 or 2.7 or a certain multiplier. This is a general thing, I don't know the nowadays what it exactly is. So basically the purchase price that they sell it buy it for from you is 2,093 euros. You also have to ship it there or bring it there or somehow, so you have to put that money on. Then the shop does it, I just did in this calculation, times 2.5. There you get to the sales price, but then you have VAT, 21%. The shop doesn't get that, but the customer has to pay for that. So that goes on top of that. So you're already on 6,633 euros for a chair, and then still it needs to be shipped to the client. So you see how quickly this adds up, and that means that the profit for the designer is that 50% of the margin. It's 1,000 euros and 46.
Well, and I guess where we all mess up, and where we messed up as well, is like you have your materials, maybe if you're lucky you can calculate your packaging, and then you have the 500 euros, and then, yeah, let's make that 50 euro profit, so it's 550, and you see you're already screwed from the beginning. So,
but in this calculation, your development hours and costs are not covered yet. So this is only if you would reproduce your work. So how much of these, whatever objects they are, you need to sell? If your profit is, let's say, 1,000 euros, and the development cost and all your hours would cost 20,000 euros, it means you already have to sell 19 objects to cover your development costs. And what? How many do you need to sell in order to make a living? How much do you need for housing, food, insurance, your car, your studio, your computer, holidays, travel, all those costs? Well, I just calculated roughly 3,000 euros per month. Then you have like a basic income where you can do no crazy things, but you can make a living. That is 36,000 euros a year. How many of these objects you need to sell in order to make this 36,000 euros? That is 34.4 objects. Meaning, if you want to start making profit, first you need to sell for 53.5 objects per year in this model. Then the question is that realistic? If you go to one shop, are they going to sell 53 objects from you of 6,000 euros? You know, this nobody knows this. The shop doesn't know, you don't know. And so should you gamble on going to one shop? Can you make agreements with the shop? How many they want to hope? How many they think they sell you? This is, I mean, it's only a little bit to gain a little bit of insight of expectations. Also on the other side, it's not you against the shop. You all work together on the same goal. Is this the way you can do it? Can you put your development costs in, or can you not? You know, it's all these questions you have to think yourself. And there is also something like, what does a customer want to pay for the work that you make? Is that realistic? Maybe this was a little vase, maybe, and that costed 6,000 euros. Is that possible, you know? And that also can see in which market are you. Do you want to compromise on making your work as effective as possible? And it might not be a compromise, because some designers are great in making choices to design an object that can be for the industry. But it means you have to take into account all the layers that goes through the industry to make an object that is much cheaper to produce in order to be able to be hosted by a label. If you decide to make your own products, you see how much also marketing you have to do, because you need to make sure you sell your work. So you cannot only go to one place and then you're only in the Netherlands. So probably you also have to go abroad. How do you find those shops? Where do you want to be? How many shops do you need? How much do you need to sell? This is something you have to think about if you really want to make a sustainable living.
Well, in the end, are it shops, or is it more the gallery market that you want to focus on? Because those prices that you already see here are more viable in the in-between gallery, more high-end design shops than you can achieve in the normal shops.
But the gallery takes maybe 50% of the whole percentage. Maybe the gallery can invest in the production cost, which is a great deal, because you don't have to invest up front. But on the other hand, it means they also have a better say about it, and they need to make a bigger margin in order to make back their investments. So what I want to say with this, it's, I mean, this is just an example. It's not exact I mean, it can be many different ways, but sometimes it really makes sense for yourself to just make a little calculation, a little sum, also to understand how much money do you need in your life in order to live a little bit normal.
Yeah.
Because for us, yeah, I think...
Peanut butter is nice, but like after a couple of months, it's too much. You need some vegetables.
We had really the sad situation that one day we had to ask our intern to buy the peanut butter and the bread because we couldn't afford it. So only we started in 2006, 2007. I think in 2010 was the first year that we had break even. So it means you don't make any profit, but you also don't lose any money. And I think in 2011 was the first time we made a little bit of profit. So it took us many years before we got there. And yeah, what do I want to say about that? I mean, it's I don't want to discourage anybody. It's just, would have been good also for us to know a bit more in advance.
Yeah, it's important to know that it is not an easy task that you're setting yourself to achieve. It's not something that everybody can do. It's something that, what's up, Janita? Or they're going like on in that path. There are always like the hundreds of questions you need to answer every week. That was just one hurdle you need to take. And you know, if you have the feeling that this is the right gallery that can push you forward, then you might consider doing that. Or it has a lot of different variables that need to be considered. But we went. Well, actually, the ghost chair, we never sold a lot of. To be honest, we sold three of those chairs. We never sold a lot of those. It's not our success story. It's that comes luckily after, but it was a valuable lesson that we had made with these pieces.
Also, you don't know exactly, you know, how it works, but you have to ask those questions. Ask if you can make an agreement about how many they think they're going to sell. Can they take five? Can they take 10? No, they can only take one of the time. Can they only take consignatie? It means you have all the risk as design. You have to put all the money up front. You should be able to do it or not. I mean, it's all about finding your way, and it has to work for both ways. It's never a one-way story. It always also has to work for the party that sells your work if you don't sell it yourself.
Consignatie, in my opinion, is not always the best option because you also want the gallery, the shop, to have a risk. You know, if they invest in you, then they have to sell. If they take it in consignatie, they will most likely focus on the piece that they invested in to sell to make their financing back. So it's also, again, something, you know, that you have to consider.
Another story. Fragile Future, it's one of the works that we still produce, and it started off as my graduation project. And at that time, it was 2005, I graduated with an installation of real dandelions, and those dandelions were glued on LEDs. And it was an installation that had to be site-specific and be made on walls. And people really didn't really know what it was, but it was
but
also...
like really didn't know what it was. Her name is Lonneke Gordijn, and people were looking at it like, is this a curtain? Like it's a... like
because Gordijn
like,
means
I don't
curtain
see how
in
see a curtain in that, but it did happen.
That's the confusion of the design, because it's very apart. But and at that time, it drew quite some attention, but also didn't work in a certain way because we got also some requests from the press. But it was so hard to photograph because if you zoom in, you see all the tiny details of the dandelions. But if you zoom out, you lose that detail. Nobody knows what it is. So it was really hard to communicate.
Yeah, but it still is. I mean, like, we're how long in our practice? 13 years? And we're still explaining people that these are real dandelions. And it's like, the number one thing I've said in my life, I think. No, real dandelions. So how do you make it? One by one with tweezers? Yeah, one by one with tweezers. And how do you keep them whole? Do you spray them with something? No, it's all like endless, like thousands of times. Yeah.
So in the beginning, it was mainly exhibitions. A lot of people wanted to show it. And at a certain point, Vivid Gallery, they're also here. Are you here? We also had just lunch with them. They are based in Rotterdam, and they asked us to be in an exhibition related to Design Miami, which is in Miami. You have two big art fairs. Well, you have several art fairs. Actually, every week there's an art fair somewhere in the world. But at that time, Miami and Basel were the big ones, the big art fairs.
Still, they also still had are.
A yeah, it's still the case. But there also is a design section in that for limited edition design, and that started off around 2007, 2008, I think, or anyway. This was the first time in Miami that this gallery was going there, and there was an exhibition next to it. It was not even on the fair, that was about nature, and they asked us to be part of that exhibition. So I said yes, but I have to build up the work. It's site-specific, can only be made on the spot because it goes on the wall. And I could take an assistant, that was Ralph, to go to Miami together. And I remember, I think we got a little bit of €1,000 from what was then, I don't remember the fund, Stimuleringsfonds, but it was then what it was then. And we went there to set up our exhibition. And then I felt like, okay, it's done, exhibition is made, I'll go to the beach.
Yeah, but that was that's also the different energy between you and me.
Exactly.
You know, I've forced you almost to stand the whole week next to the work and talk
I
to people
it.
Because otherwise there's no point. You can hang it and then people are, oh, nice, and then that's it. So
I remember we really had a big argument because I really didn't want to stand next to my work and talk about it. And you said, what else are you going to do here?
What am I doing
here? We are
here
now, you know? Yeah. We have to make the most of it.
Yeah, first of all, in that, like, Vivid, it was, I mean, yeah, really a stepping stone in our career, and we're very, really grateful to them to have taken
us there. To bring
us there,
yeah. But what did we do? We went looking around on the design fair, and we looked at the galleries that we liked. There were just a few, maybe one, that we liked the most. That was Carpenter's Workshop Gallery.
You also had...
It doesn't matter for the story.
Doesn't matter. So this one gallery, Carpenter's Workshop, they were just starting their practice, and Joep and Jeroen's, the Fuven twins, or, you know, we know them well, friends of us, they were walking around with them, and they actually introduced it to us another time, and then I saw them walking by, and I grabbed them into the show, like, have a look at this, and we're like, yes, let's make something three-dimensional out of this, because it was still a flat installation on the wall at that time. And we were actually the same week having that similar conversation, so it was just this perfect fit. And they decided to invest in the work, and that was the beginning of the success. Funny thing is, we were already thinking we were there again, like first the magazine, like, yeah, now we're here. Now we had this amazing show, okay, now we're here. And then, but then obviously after, like, now years of experiencing in this market, you still have to work every day hard to make your practice function.
Actually, I wanted to tell a little bit of story when we started with Carpenters. Carpenters Workshop Gallery is one of the we'd like to do questions after the talk.
I think, yeah, the Carpenters now, you can say
right that now it's the best, I think the best,
well, not
gallery.
I don't think you can talk, well, quality, the leading gallery, yeah, in the contemporary, okay.
You're right.
Design field.
Yeah. That's true. And so we started working with them, and they asked us to make the work, and we made the work. And it was another version of Fragile Future. It was a three-dimensional version. And we first had a discussion, because I said Fragile Future is a site-specific work. It needs to be made every time in a different way, on the spot. And they said, yeah, but a gallery, clients from a gallery don't understand that. You know, in a gallery space or in a fair, you have to put something there, and exactly that is what they're going to buy. And we said, yeah, but that's not the concept. Then said, well, then we can't work with you. So it was really like this. And I said, like, well, I don't want to compromise. And Ralph said, let's try, because this is our only way in. Let's just give it a try. Let's make one work that we make in one way that can also be in other spaces.
It was also not really compromise for me, because I kind of also like the idea just to have to work.
Yes, for me it was a bit harder. So basically, we agreed on a design. They gave us the money to make it. This is a work with phosphorus bronze strips that conduct electricity with printed circuit boards and many dandelions glued on LEDs. And with hands and tweezers, we bended every bend of that thing all by hand. We made the printed circuit boards by hand. It was like impossible to make. It was so much more work that I worked. Well, we both worked overnight. Last night we decided I would work overnight, he would sleep. Next day he drove us to Paris while I could sleep, and then we ended up in Paris in the fair.
And that was our first time in Amsterdam, right? When we got kicked out of our studio?
That was after.
That was after?
Yeah. But I think that's... anyway, what I wanted to say, we got to Paris. Sorry. Just want to finish this part. We got to Paris and we had put so many hours in it, but yes, it was not 100% straight because it was done by hand. And then the gallery said, like, no, this is not the quality we're looking for. We cannot sell this. This is shit. And we were like really like astonished because we had worked our asses off to get this done. This was our moment and they didn't accept it. And then they said, well, you know what we can do? I was probably almost crying. And they said, you know, we put it on the site, on the fair, just around the corner. People don't see it too much, but we just show it to some clients just to say, hey, this is a work in progress from a young designer. And we'll just show it and we'll see what happens. So we were so tired that we even didn't go to the opening. We just were there to deliver the work. We didn't even know there was an opening. And we were not there when the people were coming into the fair. So the next day, gallery called us. Yeah, actually, there is some interest. Maybe it's okay that it's not completely straight. And a day later...
like the whole edition sold out. So they were like, yeah, why don't we keep it a bit crooked? It can also work like this. Like, no.
So without knowing, without expectation, it became a massive success. All the works were... it was one work we put there. It was an edition of 8 and 4 artist proofs. And all 12 works were sold. And then this gallery got very, very enthusiastic. And they asked us to make 2 new works for Basel. It was a couple of weeks later. And then we said, but we cannot reproduce this. It's impossible to make. It's just like too many hours. And we sold it for a very low price. And it's just... We cannot... It just doesn't work out. And then they said, like, okay, maybe we should see if we can produce it in a bit more industrial way. So we tried to do it, and then it was way too expensive. And then they said, like, what if we make 1,000 modules? And I said, okay. And they sent me with a big bunch of money to the people that before we always had to beg, can you please make this for us? Can you please do this small order? And suddenly I had a lot of money to spend on a big order with the laser cutter and with the person that could actually bend the modules in a professional way. And together we developed with the industry, we developed the module in a way that we could actually reproduce it. But of course that wasn't finished at the next exhibition. The next exhibition was maybe 2 months later. We just had the prototypes of the things that we just set up, the production. Brought it to Basel, again, both works sold out. Now we had to produce 36 works at once. So this was actually the start of maybe the second phase of our studio, that we had to set up a production and come across with all the problems of shipping, things that break in shipping. How do you produce something? Where do you get people who can help you because you can't do it alone anymore? A whole bunch of stories. But nowadays, we still make dandelions. And we never thought this graduation project was basically the start of... which basically made our studio...
Right, it's still the backbone of the studio. It's still our most successful piece. That from this work we can put all the financing in the development that we do, and we're self-sustainable without loans or how do you call the other things?
Subsidies.
Subsidies. I hate those things. Yeah, we don't need those. So it's we're very lucky in that way. But so it was also a process.
And now we have a production. And every year we pick 15,000 dandelions. And as you can see here, we spread them out in the studio. They all open up within 48 hours. We sort them out in sizes. And then we have a team of about 20 people who work at home who glue the seats one by one on the LEDs. And 20 years ago, I think, or 15 years ago when we graduated, people thought we were crazy.
I still think you are.
But never let anybody tell you that if you believe in something, and especially something that is so vulnerable and beautiful as a natural thing, cannot be done in another way. It can just be done in this way, and it's not impossible. So nothing is impossible, I would say. Just some more pictures of
Yeah, one of our highlights in our career until now. We had a massive solo show last year in the Stedelijk Museum. There were 16 rooms with all our works. And yeah, that was interesting also to see for ourselves the relationship between all the different works. So that was, yeah, it was important.
So how to choose your own path? I think this is a very important question, because when you just graduate, you have no clue who you are, how you're going to succeed, what you're good at compared to others. We also did that. We just looked at how other people were doing it, and we were doing the same, because we thought, okay, maybe that's the way, or maybe that's the way. Nobody is going to tell you the way. We have a couple of people who did an internship in our studio, who were from Design Academy, but many other academies. And they're now here at a graduation show or in other places where they present their works. So I asked every one of them, so really nice that you present your work here, but where do you want it to go?
Yeah, like us in the beginning, I had no
exactly.
idea.
No idea. That is this going to be... Do you want this work to end in somebody's house? Do you want to be in a museum? Do you want to produce your own work? Do you want to be with a label? Do you want to do something completely else, but this is just your graduation work? What is it that you want? And I think what is an important lesson that we learned along the years that we worked is that you can actually choose yourself. Maybe you don't have all the possibilities yet when you graduate, and you have to create possibilities and also try things out. Because I think we tried out everything, kind of, and we also realized that many things didn't work for us.
No, we tried to work with labels. We like what didn't work because we just couldn't compromise. And when we did this once, it was a complete failure because the quality of the work wasn't there. So how do you stay true to yourself? And it's one of the most difficult questions, because in this process of, you know, coming from academy, you will have a lot of people coming towards you, giving you opportunities, saying this is good for you, you should do this. But a lot of people also have their own interests, and they just want to use you as a Lego piece in their big story that they're trying to push. So the sooner you know where you want to go and what you want to achieve, the more successful you will become. You know, like for example, like this friend of us, Drori, that is now in New York, is like doing these mega architectural projects. He did the whole academy in 3 years because he knew what he was doing, and he was like super fast. He went through the school, and I mean, he was also very good in what he did. But it just shows you that, you know, the sooner you know, the sooner you choose, the faster you will get to your result.
And I think we didn't really know. Things just happened. Many things happened at the same time. And I remember that after a couple of years that we started our studio, we showed our portfolio to someone at that time important in the design world in New York. And this guy said, well, you did so many things. And you have this and this and this and this and this. It looks like 10 portfolios of 10 different people. I don't see who you are. And that was very shocking for us, because we had been working our asses off, and for us it was clear. But of course, it's very important that it's also clear for an audience. What are you good at? What do you? Which projects, if you evaluate after a couple of years, which projects think you were the most successful? Which projects you distinct yourself? And I think, in our case, we did many different things, but the projects that were really the best and resonated the best with the public, but also gave us the most pleasure, were always projects that were an installation related to space. It was technology involved, and it was actually a sort of performance, something moving. That was something that fascinated us the most. And then we decided to take everything else off our website and only focus. These were only three works that we made, basically. Only focus on these three works and create our story around this.
I still can't get the ghost chair off. Just like it too much.
But it fits in what we are.
I don't know if it's. Do you think it still fits?
I think it fits, but not entirely anymore. Because also at a certain point, you know, you start coming up with a new idea, and we went to our gallery and saying, "Hey, we want to do this," and they say, "Well, that's not really for our market," and then we want to do this. Yeah, I don't know how to sell that. So you also should not limit yourself to what the interest of a gallery is. Then you have to find other ways to do your work. So this is also how we got to the idea that we had to be in the art world.
No, but also like, you know, a gallery or some other influence might pretend that they know, but they also don't know. With, you know, for Carpenters, for example, when they said, well, we need to have these ready-made edition pieces, you know, we developed these commissions, like looking at spaces and developing something specifically for it. We developed that with them, and now that's their biggest business. You know, they do that with a lot of other artists, and so it also shows you, like, nobody knows. You know, it's just you have to just follow your true path because you're going to be the best in that.
But you have to find out how it works. We decided at a certain point we wanted to be in the art world, so we went to New York, and literally we went to every single gallery to see the gallery, to see the spaces. Do they have good spaces? Which artists do they represent? Do we fit in that? So at a certain point, we were ready to have a couple of conversations with the people, but everyone was always like, "Oh, we don't do design. Oh, we like your work, but we don't do design."
Yeah, no design. We don't do design. It's a tough thing. I mean, you kind of feel, how do you call it? It's not discriminating. It's not a race thing, but it's more like, you feel judged, like your work is less because it has the label design compared to art. I mean, and then you walk over the art fair, and like 99% you see there is like, yeah, that's like a 50,000 euros. I'm like, what? So why is our work cheaper when it's like, you know, you have this highly skilled professional people making and bending all this crazy stuff, and I never understood. So
also we said we want to make a gigantic floating block of concrete. What is design about that? No, yeah. You're a designer.
Yeah,
so you cannot make your work. It's basically for us always, it's not about being a designer, being an artist. We just want to make the works that we have in mind, that we think are relevant, that we want to make. And for that, you have to find the way and the possibilities to do it.
But basically, it took 5 years of, you know, talking to the right galleries, finding the people that, you know, understand the crossovers, the links. And then luckily, we now are with Pace Gallery, what is one of the largest art galleries in the world. So they give us a whole new field of opportunity that we still need to work and focus on. It's not like, okay, now we're in this gallery again. It's like same as in the magazine. We're there. No, of course we're not.
You still have to
make it all happen. Focus on the right pieces. Focus on the right people to work with and the story that you want to tell.
But nobody picks you up and brings you where you want to go. You always have to carry yourself wherever you are. And you have to be up for that. So in order to do that, it's also very important to think for yourself, where do you want to be? But also, who do you want to be with? I think I made a mistake. Right? Where do you want to be? Oh yeah, who do you want to be and who are you? I was looking for that one.
So if you do something, who are you, Lonneke?
Well, it's very funny because not so long ago, I looked through my little book where I wrote my concepts and all the ideas, what I was thinking of during my graduation here at the Design Academy. And it was exactly what we're doing nowadays. And that was just a thought, you know, it was just like wandering off, writing down my thoughts. And I think what we also have come across is you can only keep up with this and be persistent and also have the energy to bring it as far as you need to take it if it's very close to who you are and why you want to do this. If it's something that you make up but it's outside of who you are, I think if you miss that connection with yourself, I think it's impossible to keep up with this, also this life in this way. I think in my case, in Ralph's case, I mean, if you look back, it sounds always very simple, but it is that way. If you look back at if you don't know who you are, but you look at your works, you see what is the common factors between things, the aspects that you really like in your own works. And then if you think back with who you are, who you were when you were a child, and what the choices were that you made. Were you making up stories? Were you into adventures? Were you freaking on Lego? Were you creating your own drawings? What was the thing and what is the essence of what you already liked? Because I think it's already very early in your life that you are becoming a person that you roll out when you're older.
Well, for us that both works, as I'm very fascinated by science fiction, technology. I was always working on motorbikes, cars, and losing myself in his Star Wars universe, reading this extended universe and freaking out. And I still love that, and I still try to incorporate that in my work every day. And that's how I know that what I do is purely me, instead of, you know, looking at what is selling now, who is doing what, so what is an interesting thing, everybody jumping on ecology, okay, I'm going to do that, or everybody's wearing these shoes, so I'm going to wear these shoes. I mean, it doesn't, then you're no personality, it just becomes just this endless machine that you need to run after, and then you will never do what is truly yourself, and therefore, I think, never be happy. But so I guess that's...
Yeah, you also have like funding institutions that say the next year we're going to focus on Brazil, China, and India. And then everyone starts to come up
Seriously?
With ideas about like India.
What the hell do we have to do in India? Like, are you going to sell a chair in India? People have nothing
chair.
To eat.
I mean,
it's so stupid. But then, you know, because the government is just focusing on this and they push you in this direction. And sometimes it's institutions, they need designers to make certain links within their own organization or to government parties that they want to link up to. And then you're used as the glue to make that introduction. You know, just don't let yourself be used in that way. Just focus on where you want to be. Think, okay, where's my market? Who do I want to reach? And then go for it straight away.
But also, I think feeling-wise, creative people, designers, artists, whatever profession, and maybe also if you're not a creative person, but what it's about is, I mean, the sensitivity of this time, why you feel certain needs, why you want to do certain things. It always reflects this time. This is so much more important and leading than following someone that actually is supporting the creative industry. I mean, what the creative industry should support is should be following what all of you guys are doing and what we are doing and what we are doing together. From that, you can make a distillation of what is important and what actually... I mean, we are this generation. We live it. We feel those needs. That's why we make certain things. I think especially, well, I think everyone has that. It's a reflection of this time, and that's what you should focus on. Not yeah. because of... don't follow the money, basically, because at the end, you have to support your work and you have to make it happen. And yes, you need money to make your projects. And definitely, you have to find that. But first should come where you want to go, who you want to be, and what should be here and what makes sense.
Yeah.
I think we want to end off with one of our projects that was also like a complete madness, a rat race to take it off.
Yeah, just examples of like how crazy an idea can be and like that, you know, everything is possible, but it will take you a lot of effort, a lot of energy. You might also not even be able to balance your private life with it, but that's also sometimes the sacrifice that might be worth it, sometimes not. But it's like, it's not an easy task that we're setting out, and it shouldn't be, because if it was, then everybody would do it. So, yeah, just from start of on, be prepared or not to do the work. And if you don't, then don't. And if you do, do. I mean, does that make sense?
Okay, so this project, it started with Flylight, which is a project we just actually installed in Domus Dela here in Eindhoven. But it started in 2007 when this project came alive. It's maybe we can play the video for a little bit. So I'll click through very quickly, but it's a project.
never like that, you know, at the end of your life. So if you know that in hindsight, maybe you make different choices. So yeah, we hope to capture that essence with the work.
So we made a light installation and we programmed swarming behavior, so the lights were going through. And well, we were quite happy with it. But very soon, our idea was like, okay, this is nice, but everything is hanging. What would happen if all these lights were really flying and make these swarm patterns in the sky? This question came up in 2009, about 10 years ago. And that was the start of our project and our mission to accomplish one of the projects that we're incredibly happy with, but was also like, well, a risk like no other. It's called Franchise Freedom, and we decided to work with drones.
And well, we were looking for something that could carry the light source physically in the sky, and this is like 2008, 2007. There are no drone companies. There's no professional people around. There were some universities playing around with quadcopters, trying to get certain things airborne and do some studying. So we basically went around the world talking to universities, see who we could work with to make these swarm algorithms incorporate in drones. And well, luckily on the way we motivated some people to start working. Again, we don't have any funding, so we can't go to major corporations and say, here, if you 10 million, please, I'll hope to see it in a couple of years, or not if it fails. But this one company, they, well, to be completely honest, it went a bit weird, but at a certain point we were going there with an investor and they said, well, you don't need to come anymore, we're gonna do it ourselves. Like, okay. So that was the first moment that I thought like, oh fuck, so we lose the project, but at least we tried. So they got another German company involved that started developing the technology. That technology luckily got bought by Intel. And then the first company was kicked out. So they were off the table. And then we had to convince Intel again to work with them. Like, hey, we have this project and this idea. Can we work with your tech? How can we incorporate this swarming behavior? Well, also on the backside, we were working with Delft on the creating our own hardware, but that wasn't that successful. So
basically, the University of Delft gave us like a quote for 1.5 million to develop the technology, but they could not guarantee us that it would work.
No.
And we were like, well, you know, maybe we can raise 1.5 million, but then if it doesn't work, what do we do? I mean, it doesn't make any sense. So through the Delft University, we got in contact with the partner that we still work with, Lucas. And he knew
the guys from that company, so we with
from
him.
Intel.
Yeah, so for like extending technologies like that would work with Intel. So they could again work together. And long story short, 12 years later.
Well, I think what we had to do, we had to convince a huge tech company to work with two artists from Amsterdam. And they were really like, who the hell are you? We don't need you, you know? We make our own drone shows. And because they had developed the hardware and they had just flying two shows or three shows, just very limited amount. And so we had to go to them, talk to them, convince them that this was something completely different, that there was autonomous swarming behavior, that was something different than making a heart in the sky with drones, that is actually a flat image where the drones are flying.
Well, I mean, you're going to a tech company telling them, hey, it's nice what you've done, but you're actually devaluating your own market. I mean, you're going to put a heart in the sky, you do it three times, everybody's going to be bored, and that's it. So let's make an art piece, you know, you can endlessly engage in, like as natural processes, it's like going to the ocean, like what you always say, it's not you go once and then you say, like, I've seen the ocean. No, you like to go every day to just get into the natural rhythm. And that's what we wanted to do with this piece, that it just becomes a piece of nature again with this technology. And so the first time, so we got them finally that far that we could test.
Well, no. I first want to say, we didn't have the money, but we had at a certain point we had Intel on board, and we said, okay, to Intel, we have the money. We didn't. And then we, at the same time, we thought, how are we going to get this money? So we went and we got in contact because we looked at which big sponsors have a benefit from sponsoring artworks without them changing the artwork. So we wanted to keep the artwork without, you know, having to put a logo or something like that. So there was BMW, and BMW, another big corporate company, they invest quite a lot in artwork. So I remember that Ralph got the chance to meet with them and said, okay, I have to change my flight, I can meet with them tomorrow, let's do it. So he went, had a couple of drinks with a girl from from BMW.
It was not like that.
And she
all.
Was... and they got very enthusiastic. They said, we have a budget of 150K. We said, like, okay, sure. Well, we knew we couldn't do it for that. And we told BMW, we have the technology. Intel wants to work with us. So basically, from two sides, we had Intel hanging, we had BMW hanging, and we needed much more money from BMW. BMW didn't have that money.
So we also had the location set out in Miami.
Everything was hanging around us, but we still had to make this deal. So we were in the middle of huge corporations and expectations and a gallery and Art Basel, who were all looking with us. At the end of the time, we could close the deal. BMW became so enthusiastic that with their art budget they couldn't fulfill it, but they convinced internally the entire worldwide BMW marketing team to support us. And then on the other hand, we also had to do some marketing things for them, but also they also wanted us to fly BMW in the sky, and we always said, like, well, we'll see, you know, we'll see if we can do that. But in the end of the time, we said, we can't do that, I'm sorry.
No, I basically told them, like, we can't do it with the technology that we have, it just doesn't work.
And then we went to testing. We had a development of the software. That was the part that we did. We had a developer in-house every day. We looked at swarms. We developed the software. And finally, we had only seen it on a screen. We were there to test it. First, we went testing in Germany on an old abandoned air
how you say strip.
It? Yeah, airstrip. And I can't tell.
No, you can't tell. Anyway, so the first time they were flying, and we're having the technicians next to us. This is in Silicon Valley, when they were flying above this parking space. It's quite funny because cars, like, driving on the highway, they all rushed in and were like, "What's this?" And like, because nobody's seen something like this. The technicians say to us, "Okay, it's working as what we're seeing on the computer. Let's pack it up. It's done." But we were very upset because we were not feeling the work as we wanted to. We couldn't relate to it in the sense that it didn't feel like a natural element yet. So we still had a lot. We have 60 parameters in the programming that we can adjust that we needed to play with, you know, with the cornering of the light intensity, the dimming quality, and everything. So, but after convincing them, and this is also...
Well, we had to put up a fight with Intel because they didn't understand. What do you mean, don't feel it? It works, right?
But these are technicians. They don't think in the sense of feeling. They're mathematicians.
But if you don't feel the work, why would you at all make it? You know, people, we want to enhance an audience, meaning everyone who sees it has to get a certain feeling. If we already don't feel it, we cannot pretend it's good, right? That's not how it works.
So the first time it actually was working on the beach in the way that when we won it was the first time we were flying it in Miami during Art Basel, and then we had again the technicians next to us, and it's like, okay, we understand what you mean now. And they also got emotionally involved. It was an important moment because we also believe that this could be a function of the creatives in the tech industry, is to open up that conversation about why are you developing certain technologies. Is this just another money machine? Are you just jumping on tech for the hell of sake of tech? Or do you want to contribute something to society? Do you want to touch people in a certain way? Do you want them to think in a certain way? How can you engage your developments into a more socialistic aspect of our society? And I don't know. Yeah, so I was super happy when it actually happened.
It was also quite interesting to work with these big corporate companies because they have complete different ideas than us. Because we just want to make this work and it has to be as good as possible. We want to make it happen. That's our objective. Their objective is to get as many people seeing it through their channels and Instagram and whatever and press. And then Intel was not even thinking about press. So we said to Intel, you know, we had all this marketing and press meetings with BMW and everything was aligned. And we said a couple of times to Intel, hey, if you want to have a few lines for the press, let us know. They said, no, they didn't even reply. And then we had a huge article in the New York Times about the drones in Miami, and they were like, why are we not named the day after?
No, like the director from BMW, he got, no, from Intel.
From
he
Intel,
got like
yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, got Intel got really upset, and they threatened us to not fly anymore the next day if we wouldn't change all our communication and put Intel in it. And BMW was, because we had to pay Intel, they were not giving it to us. BMW was paying Intel, and BMW said, like, what the hell? We are paying them.
So why should we
put
them?
It in? So we were in the middle of this fight between everyone,
yeah,
and felt like we couldn't do it anymore. So it means it comes in the end. We solved everything, you know. We aligned everything. Everything was fine. But you can imagine that the if there is a lot of money involved, also the pressure is on. You have to deliver, and everyone gets stressed because everyone can lose their face in their company. And you have to understand, like a brand. Can especially Intel, who works with drones. Drones can have a very negative connotation. It has been associated with wars and stuff. Even that these drones are not developed for that at all. It has nothing to do with it.
It's also bold for them to invest in this hardware because, you know, if the drone falls out of the sky, it's an Intel chip that fails. This is a $1 billion industry. So they are like super protective of like how and what and all the rules. What is logical? So, but that also made it possible because otherwise we would not get the licensing of flying above the beach or like at Burning Man as we recently did, or for the 50th anniversary for NASA that we just flew above the Rocket Garden. Like all these amazing opportunities. I mean, there's a lot of rules involved that we maybe took for granted in the beginning, but by working also with these large corporations, we learned to navigate them.
And coming off for this project, we just wanted to use this technology only for this one artwork, but we have gone through so many developments that actually it's a shame to only use it once. And so we have a spin-off from this work that is now a company that's almost signed, that we've already been working on for 2 years, and our lawyer is also sitting here in the audience who is involved in that process, which is very hard for us. So we're also learning along the way how it works to have investors in a separate company and to pull that off. And we wanted to end up with saying we keep on learning, we constantly get into new situations like this thing where with a startup, tech startup and investors. And we also don't know what the next step is. We are still in that sense in the same stage as some of you are here in the audience who don't know how to start their business. We have no clue. We just do it and see what happens and how it comes along.
Do we have a film?
Yeah, we have a film, but maybe it's a bit late, I see. We have 10 we more have minutes before Martin.
10? I thought two.
We already? Sorry? Keep going? Okay. So we want to end. We wanted to end with the film of the drone performance we did at Burning Man a year ago, and
after that we can have some questions.
Yeah.
first of all, give Lonneke a great round of applause for
her come on.
amazing presentation.
Well, for both of us. Thank you.